Right. We're in Hebrews 11. And I would like to read for you verses 23 through 29 about the faith of Moses. It says, "By faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents because they saw he was a proper child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured," now here's our text, "as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and sprinkling of the blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians are saying to do were drowned." This chapter has been called Faith's Hall of Fame. If we were to read verses 32 through 40, I won't. Recently I have. You'll see that there were people of faith that endured untold tragedy. But yet, they walked with God in great victory. Tragedy that we've never even understood. And how were they able to do that? Well, it was just like Moses. How was he able to do it? Because they saw him who was invisible. Seeing him that is invisible. Can I tell you, you can go through anything if the Lord is with you. And you can know he's with you based on the Word of God and the Spirit of God. The true essence of faith is revealed to us in verse 1. That's what sets the tone for the chapter. It says, "Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen." See, I want to tell you something. Faith is not blind. It's not just a belief system that tries to make us feel good. Christian faith, Ephesians 3:12 says this, "In whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of him." That's the substance of things hoped for. It is he that gave us this faith. It's a substance, and it's based on him. Amen. And it's based on his word. Romans 15:4 says, "For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope." Amen. Faith is the evidence of things hoped for. Amen. It is by him through the scriptures that we have hope. So faith is not blind. It's the Bible based on what Christ did. Faith is also not a trust in the unknown, but it's definitely a trust in the unseen. Amen. There's things we see in the scriptures that you'd never see with the naked eye. What that is that is the evidence. The evidence is in the testimony of the believer. In other words, not only have I seen things that are hoped for, but you also bear evidence of the same. Amen. It's a real faith. It's not a blind walking in the darkness. In Philippians 3:10, Paul said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. 2 Corinthians 3 tells us, "Ye are our epistle written in our hearts, known and read of all men. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart." The evidence of faith is that I'm sitting here with people in this same room that love the same Jesus and have the same testimony, and it's based on the same Word of God, and we all say the same thing. We are witnesses to these things. We present evidence that cannot be overturned. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I don't know what you're going through right now, but I do know a little bit about who God is through His Word. I do know that. And I think that if we'll get a better glimpse of the invisible one, if we'll see Him that is invisible, we'll never be the same. I believe we'll walk through a valley and come out the other side way better than what we predicted before we went into it. So from these verses, I want to look at the life of Moses just a little bit. I don't want to get into a full story or anything, but I want to look at some of the things that Hebrews 11 here says about Moses and discover how we can do like he did by getting a glimpse of Jesus. Amen. Don't forget that it says in verse 26, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. This ain't just about an ominous God. This is through Christ. And I believe that we can get a glimpse of Him and we can know Him better and see Him which is invisible. Amen? So let's get into this. I got a few thoughts here. First of all, I want to show you the traits of those who see Him. The traits of those who see Him. In verse 23, by faith Moses, when he was born. Now that's interesting. He was hid. Now this was all by faith. See, Moses wasn't old enough to put faith in God, but it's by the faith of God that Moses was hidden, you see. In other words, his birth was special. It was not just everyday guy being born. It was a special birth, though not miraculous, like our Lord Jesus Christ or like Samuel, at least as far as we know, or even like John the Baptist. But we know that his birth was special. Let me tell you, according to John chapter 3 and verse 3, the Bible says, if we're going to see him that's invisible, it has to start with being born again. It has to start with having spiritual eyes. He says, except a man be born again, he can't enter and he can't see the kingdom of God. The new birth brings us into the place of blessing like Moses. Romans 8 and verse 7 backs this up when it says, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So we find that it takes a change, a birth from within by the miraculous power of God, which Jesus Christ calls being born again, which we doctrinally like to call the regeneration. Amen. So you see the traits of those who see him. First, they must have a special birth or you'll never see him. Amen. Because you're carnal. In verses 24 and 25, we see another trait of those who see him, and that is that they have a separated life. In verse 24, it says, by faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. I want to tell you something. Clean living will bring you closer to God. PJ's devotion this morning put that out pretty clearly, that if we will just let God have our heart and clean up our sin and turn from our wicked ways, that He will hear our prayers, that He will bless us. It makes us closer to Him. Isaiah 59:2 says, but your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sins have hid His face from you, that He will not hear. But I want to tell you, those that see Christ, seeing Him who is invisible, they have a special birth and they have a separated life. Let me tell you what else they have. They have a supernatural faith. This faith is not conjured. This faith is not built on their emotions, their will, or determination. This faith is brought to them by the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 28 says, through faith He kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land. Look at the exploits that happened here. These are all miracles. These are all things that God said, if you'll do, if you'll follow me, I'm going to bring miracles into your life that will separate you from the Egyptians. You're going to have a supernatural faith that the world knows nothing of. You know, over and over, we could give testimonies that match walking through the Red Sea on dry ground. Amen. God has done miraculous things in our life. And even as PJ said here in introduction today, he said the mercy and grace of God is good to everybody. That lady that just wrecked outside the door that some of us saw, some of us heard, she came back out basically with a scratch. Amen. God was merciful to her. When you flip a truck, usually you're going to die. But God was merciful to her. Amen. He's so merciful, but we live a supernatural faith. Man, I'm telling you, I've got so many blessings in my life right now. People tend to want to focus on the negative, and our old flesh wants to focus on the negative. But can I tell you, no matter what I face, no matter what valley I'm in, no matter what depth of the sea in a whale's belly, God still hears me, and the faith that He gave me will pull me through, and I don't even have to see Him. You understand? Amen. I'm seeing Him who is invisible because He's given me a supernatural faith. Let me tell you what else He gave. He gives those that see Him. He gives them a superb victory. Look at verse 29, right there in the beginning. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land. Oh, my friends, that is fantastic. Whether we win or lose, the actual battles of life is really immaterial, because we can be victorious whether we win or lose. Whether we come out from the courts unscathed, or whether we do like those men that we saw in the martyr's mirror today and go to our death, it doesn't matter. We still have the victory. We sing the song over and over. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. The faith that is supernatural brings us a superb victory. Though the world may think we're losers, I want to tell you, God knows we're winners. And when it's all done, we'll be with Him.
Amen.
Every time we see the invisible one, it gives us courage to fight on. Isaiah saw Him high and lifted up. Stephen saw Him standing at the right hand of God. Paul saw Him in the third heaven. The three Hebrews saw Him in the fire. Daniel saw Him through prayer before he ever entered that lion's den. And I'm going to tell you today, those of us who see Him, we have the traits of being born again. He gives us a separated life, a supernatural faith, a superb victory. And it all comes through the Word of God, through the admonitions of the brethren based on the Word of God, and through the preaching based on the Word of God. We can see Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Now, thanks be unto God, which always causeth us to triumph in Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of His knowledge by us in every place. Every place. It doesn't matter where you are. I'll give you another thought. So we saw the traits of those who see Him. They have a special birth, a separated life, a supernatural faith, and a superb victory. But let me also tell you, there are troubles of those that see Him. The troubles of those who see Him. First of all, in verse 25, we see that they endure suffering. He says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Moses suffered. Don't you know half the time they thought he was crazy? Don't you know that his mantra by the sinners was probably snatching defeat from the jaws of victory? Because he had everything he ever needed, but he turned his back on that because he saw Him who's invisible. He saw Christ. He was born again. He had the faith of Christ, and he walked with Christ and forsaken these other things, and it caused him to suffer. In Psalm 23, we read about a shepherd who has already led us through the valley of the shadow of death. He's in front of us. He sees the way. He's the light. He can't help but know the end from the beginning. And it always leads to a table set in the wilderness. It leads to a place of great blessing. When Christ has taken us through the valley, all we have to do is hold on to that rod and that staff, and we will see Him who is invisible. That's His character. That's what He does. And He has a way of turning defeat into victory. From that valley to a table spread for me. Amen. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:57, but thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have the victory. We see Him. We endure suffering because we see Him. We know Him. Sometimes only in the valley of suffering will you see Him who's invisible, isn't that right? But I've always found it makes it worth the pain. Job 23:10, but He knoweth the way that I take, and when He hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. So the troubles of those who see Him, first of all, they endure suffering. The second thing I want to point out is that they endure solitude. Look at verse 27, just the very beginning. He says, by faith he forsook Egypt. Moses was 40 years old when he left Pharaoh's court and went and hid in the wilderness. He spent 40 years in the wilderness, and then God called him to come back and set his people free, and he spent 40 years leading God's people through the wilderness. It's interesting. It's like for 40 years he was a somebody, and then the next 40 years he was a nobody, and then the last 40 years Christ showed him what he can do with a nobody. Amen. Boy, is that not, and I thank God I don't live in these 40-year increments of growth. Praise the Lord. But isn't that what God has done with all of us through this? We become nobodies. We are in solitude. There's times when you walk alone as far as human companionship is concerned. Am I right? I know I am. There's times you'll be alone based on your beliefs, but if you're saved, you'll never be alone spiritually. Matthew 28:20, Jesus said, "And I will be with you even unto the end of the world. Amen." The Bible tells us that in Hebrews 13 and verse 5, that He will never leave us nor forsake us. He's always been there. He always understands. And I want to tell you, I know that being lonely can hurt, but Jesus can make it worthwhile. Daniel was lonely. Jesus was lonely. Paul was lonely. And I bet you right now they're shouting glory, hallelujah to God every instance of the rest of eternity. Amen. Because they saw Him who's invisible. And I need to see Him. Boy, when we get troubles, we always want to bark back at the troubles. But the reality is, if we see Him that's invisible, those troubles pass away because He's just too glorious to look at. He's just too wonderful to look at. The troubles of those who see Him, they endure suffering, they endure solitude. But let me also point out that they endure shame. Verse 26 again, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in heaven. You see there? Esteeming the reproach of Christ. Moses suffered shame. He was probably called a fool by many people. I want to tell you, there's going to be times when it isn't popular to be saved. Matter of fact, 2 Timothy 3:12 makes it clear that yea, and all who will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But let me tell you, the end is worth the middle. The end is worth the middle. Jesus will get you through these tough times. You'll get closer to Him. It will be worth it all. We're going to see Him better when we get to the other end of that trial. I think that's why sometimes He allows the trials, is because we're not seeing Him as well as we should. So, the traits of those who see Him, they have a special birth, a separated life, a supernatural faith, a superb victory. The troubles of those who see Him, they endure suffering, they endure solitude, they endure shame. But let me also tell you the tactics of those who see Him. The tactics of those who see Him. Number one, they make the right commitments. When we see Jesus, we will make the right commitments. Not the wrong ones, the right ones. Look at verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Look at verse 27. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing Him who is invisible. Verse 28 says, through faith, he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. Listen, faith enabled Moses to make all the right commitments in his life. He committed his way to the Lord Jesus Christ, seeing the invisible. He committed his walk. He committed his will all to the Lord and allowed the Lord to direct his paths. Now, Psalm 37, verse 23 and 24, we sing it all the time. It says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hand. When you walk in the way that the Lord has ordered through His Word, you can bet He's going to take care of you. And when you're saved, and when you see Christ who is invisible, you will make the right commitments in your life, and it'll be based on the Word of God and not on the flesh. or temporary insanity like I have sometimes. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, listen to this. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Acknowledge him. How do we do that? Through the word of God. I don't know about you, but every time I pick up this Bible, I see him who is invisible. Don't you? Amen. So they make the right commitments. Verse 25 shows us they make the right choices. Choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Faith will enable you to choose God's way over what may seem to be easier for you. Those who see him choose to walk in his paths. Verse 26 also tells us that they make the right calculations. He says, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. Esteeming, estimating. Those who see him know that the end of their faith justifies the journey. Therefore, we are able to count everything in our lives as dung, except for those things that glorify Christ. It's interesting, we're going to be talking about that text Wednesday night. Well, next time we meet on Wednesday night. So I said all that to say this, and I will not hold you long because it's hot in here. We've eaten, and y'all are doing very well, but I'm not going to hold you long. But have you seen him lately? Have you seen him lately, or have we got to a place in our lives where we can only see our troubles? If we can only see our troubles, we're not seeing him who is invisible. We've gotten away from the principle of, wait a minute, he's got this. He's in charge of this. I know him. I know him. He saved me. I met him one day. And through his blood, he washed me clean. And he raised me up to walk in the newness of life with him and for him and about him. But sometimes, I don't know about you, I don't see him who is invisible as much as I could. So have you seen him lately? Is your life even in a place where it's possible to see him? All you need to do is get where you can see and just look. Amen. You say, well, where can I see, Brother Sam? By getting right with God. If there's something between you and God, something between you and your brother, whatever, get that right. Forgive somebody that needs to be forgiven, or go get forgiveness where you need the forgiveness, and turn to Christ and let him instruct you out of his word and through prayer and at church and through your service, and see him. See him. I tell you, the ultimate thing is when we go out street preaching and we're standing there preaching, we all see him. We see him. We know him. And all those around us are just blind and they don't know him, and they're feeling their way. They have ears that cannot hear. They're like stone. They can hear our audible words, but then we show them the doctrines of Christ and they cannot hear it. It's still about them. Well, if Jesus is real, I'd like to meet him. Well, right here is his word, and his spirit is working right now. And he is coming back. You don't want to wait till then to see him. Amen. I've never met the Lord Jesus Christ personally, eye to eye, touch his physical body. But I can tell you, on November 3rd, 1991, I met the Lord Jesus Christ, and he changed my life forever. And I'm going to tell you that since that time, there's been times of declension. There's been times where I'm not in a place to see him as I ought. There's been times where sin has crept back in and I'm overwhelmed with the very thing he made me free from. But I found that every time through life, when you cast away those things and go back to the word of God in repentance, I found that he just seems to turn the lights on more and more, and I know him more and more. And I'm telling you, I can describe a whole lot about him just because I've seen him who is invisible. Have you seen him? Are you like Moses? I know this was short and a little bit devotional, but I want it to be an encouragement, because I think that right now, some of the things we're seeing, the hard times we're having, I think this is the beginning of sorrows. I don't think this is the end game. I think we're going to see harsher things in our lives. I believe we're going to have more heartbreaks. The world hates the church. We're going to have more problems and heartbreaks. But if we see him that's invisible, there's a Red Sea that's waiting for us to cross over. There's something. God has something, doesn't he? And we can walk with him. So, amen. Let's stop right there. I hope that was a blessing to you.